The convoy lies stealthily before dawn off the wide beaches of Oran. A signal from the convoy. And from pro-ally French ashore, a pre-planned answering signal. The zero hour. In the dawn, with watchful allied anti-aircraft gunners furnishing protection for the landings, warships lying close to lay down a protecting smoke screen on the North African shore. The first waves of British and American invaders scramble down the landing nets flung over the sides of their transports. Precisely this exact moment of the early morning, at scores of carefully selected beachheads along 700 miles of the North African coast, other troops are landing in countless thousands. British and Americans together in one gigantic invasion, compared to which the German invasion of Norway was a small commando raid. Troops and supplies from hundreds of transports along the entire coastline sweep ashore. The beginning of a major offensive Allied action to drive the Axis from the Mediterranean and wrest full control of the entire area. In successive waves, the first assault troops, and then wave after wave of British and American infantrymen, signalmen, artillerymen, engineers, medics, armored forces arriving on the North African beaches and gathering their countless quantities of supplies and equipment to consolidate their landings. The Allies have arrived. The second largest harbor in Algeria, Oran, is quickly occupied by the eastbound Allied forces with little or no resistance from the local French. From the White House in the United States had come a message.
Mes amis, les Américains, avec l'aide des Nations Unies, font tout ce qu'ils peuvent pour établir un avenir sain.
Have faith in our words. We do not want to cause you any harm. We assure you that once the menace of Germany and Italy is removed from you, we shall quit your territory at once. I am appealing to your realism, to your self-interest and national ideals. Do not obstruct, I beg of you, this great purpose. Grateful for their liberation from further vain resistance in the name of Vichy, French soldiers gladly lay down their arms and await reorganization to fight on the side of the Allies. Miles east of Oran, 200 miles nearer Sicily and Italy, in Algiers harbor, an Allied convoy rides at anchor under barrage balloon protection. The officials have already accepted the Allies, and peacefully British Tommies and Yankee warriors swarm ashore, a scant 24 hours after the pre-planned moment of the first landings. Some of these men are seasoned British veterans of France and Norway. Most of them are clerks or mechanics, American farmers or British laborers. Men from the cities, men from the plains of the world's two greatest democracies. Allied soldiers, ready to fight their common enemy now gathering in Tunisia. Quickly they move eastward down the wide coastal highways, with heavier equipment already ashore, ready to carry the attack forward. Integral part of the vast secret Allied strategy, to the east at El Alamein, for 2 weeks the British 8th Army has been crumbling the frontal defenses of the Nazi Africa Corps. And just before the zero hour in Algeria, a fierce and endless succession of fighters, dive bombers, and heavy bombers dealt the death blow to Field Marshal Rommel's hopes of North African conquest. As relentless bombs harass the remnants of Rommel's shattered army, British artillery in unceasing fire moves the 8th Army forward in pursuit of a beaten enemy. Westward, deeper and deeper into Libya, past the wreckage of the Africa Corps and Marshal Goering's vaunted Luftwaffe, British drive moves on without cessation, harrying Rommel's fleeing rear guard with continuous assault by air and land. Supplies and equipment and reinforcements for frontline troops move constantly forward. To keep lines of supply intact, in the wake of the furious and unceasing British drive under the command of Britain's brilliant General Bernard Montgomery. In the desert, panic-stricken Italian prisoners by the thousands, deserted by their Axis ally, gratefully accept British protection, throwing down their guns and giving themselves up willingly. Back in Algeria, the mopping up of Germans in the captured cities is quick and thorough. Armed with secret lists, Allied agents in Algiers quickly round up the German Armistice Commission, caught red-handed by the invaders, while elsewhere in the city, frightened Italian and German visitors, the Axis-famed 5th Column, are rounded up for permanent internment. There they go, and with them, all Axis hopes of conquest of North Africa. No longer is the native population frightened to show its hatred of the Axis, or to wildly cheer their American protectors as they arrive. As U.S. forces pause behind the eastward moving front to decorate the heroes of the landing, general and doughboy alike are soberly aware that this can be no more than the beginning. Now, for the first time since the war began, there is real opportunity for U.S. fighting men to mix in battle with the Nazi, to drive him out of Africa. From bases in England, from bases in Egypt and Libya, from bases in Oran and Algiers, U.S. liberators and flying fortresses, British Lancasters, Stirlings, Halifaxes, pouring two-ton blockbusters down on an Italy already chafing under German domination. There will be no let-up. There will be no relief. These bombings will get only worse and worse until the Allies have won.